handing over to governance for the show, with ethics for the dough, with Professor Jeroen van den Hoven, and he is advising President of the European Union, the Commission actually, Juncker. He's in the ethics committee over there. He has also brought forward the program on responsible innovation, also the European Commission, and let's see what he has to tell us today.
Thank you very much, Dirk. Yes, Dirk said ethics is my field, and as many speakers already have indicated, we'd like to hang on to ethics and human values for a while, as long as we can, and make some efforts towards that. So therefore we need to shift gears, and we need to also change the way ethics has been conducted. So it's also, I'm also preaching to my fellow philosophers. I will talk about two notions that, according to our research and things that we've been looking at, should be prominent. This is designing for values, so turning ethics into a design enterprise of some sorts, and this idea of responsible innovation for a digital society. The idea is that these values have a specific normative direction of fit, and we should impose them as, you know, we should investigate to what extent we can impose them upon the world. The world should fit the way we want it to be, and we think it ought to be. And that is a specifically ethical enterprise. So directions of fit. If you go to a shoe shop, you adjust the size of your shoes to your feet and not the other way around. So it's the same direction of fit that I like to. So innovations can be really good and helpful, and we have many of them. They can also be not so very good. So the idea is, the first question that we have to ask, it is innovative, it adds new functionality, has been pointed out, just a little functionality, but the question is it good? It's not per se. We have to do independent investigation into it. A frivolous example, the Amazon Dash buttons, kind of Internet of Things application. You can stick it on your fridge and you order just by pushing it, whatever you're running out of. So in this case, it's ham and macaroni, Kraft cheese or something like that. Of course, before you know, you have your household full of these, because they're geared towards specific products and they're all over the place. And so the question is this really a very good idea? No. So we have to think about, is this a responsible innovation? It deals with some of our problems, but it's probably not the most important problem, and also probably we haven't proceeded in a responsible way towards realizing it. So is it innovative, but is it good? We should perhaps aim at solving some problems where we can really make a difference with respect to all the problems that have been so beautifully articulated and alluded to by the previous speakers. There's no shortage of these problems, right? So we have the grand challenges, we have the Millennium Goals, Alois already kind of discussed these, the UN Sustainable Development Goals. One way or the other, technology will be part of the problem, or we realize it's part of the problem, or it's part of the solution. And also the UN has now realized this, and before every high-level meeting, they have now a meeting that they call of the technology facilitation mechanism. So they realize that technology is part of this equation, and they should address it as such. This is in good European tradition. In Rome, we endorsed the so-called Rome Declaration on Responsible Innovation. It's in a tradition of thinking, as Dirk already referred to, the European Commission is thinking along those lines. And I think if we look at the world map that Alois showed, there's a real opportunity for us to do something new and to do something distinctively European. This all came out, I modestly state, out of the initiative 8 years ago with the Dutch Research Council. It's called Responsible Innovation, huge success, almost 40 million spent on it, and it's part of the official Dutch innovation policy. It's a top sector, kind of cross-cutting theme. All the new things that we come up with need to be responsible, preferably. So what are we talking about concretely? I give two examples. I could give 50, 100. We collate these in our research program. I just give you a Dutch example, the ethical Fairphone. Right, so this is a phone, a design that picked up many prizes for responsible innovation. Why? Because all the blue labels that you see there represent a societal, moral, legal requirement. Fair wage for the people who've been working on it. The stuff that is made of is not from countries that are run by dictators and filling their coffers. Right? It has an e-waste program associated with replaceable battery, etc. So this design of this thing accommodates six, but more in the new versions, moral requirements in one design. Another example, street lighting on demand, just an issue, safety, security, and sustainability, all accommodated in one architecture, in one design, a socio-technical system. Now that's the structure that we're interested in, because we're doing something really special. So what are these examples that strike us as smart and responsible? What are they examples of? Well, I suggest design of new functionality that allows us to expand the set of obligations that we can satisfy. Suddenly, we can now satisfy safety, security, sustainability instead of only one of these. Right? We're confronted with tragic, dilemmatic choices, and now we have actually, by changing the world, we have made it true that we can satisfy more of our obligations. So hang on to that. This is the core of the advice that made this the European Commission decide to make this idea of responsible innovation a core notion in Horizon 2020. So there's 500 million available still, it's running out, but there's 500 million available across all domains, all DGs, for responsible innovation in transport, in electricity, in IT. And this is the definition, I won't go into it, but the new thing about it, so what is ethics, what is responsible innovation? Well, think about the options, think about the consequences of all of those options, assess them in terms of your moral values, and now the important thing, the new thing, is use this not for a dinner table conversation or to edify your audience, but use them as requirements for new designs. So this is a design shift in ethics, and it needs to be made. It will benefit from doing this early on and not later, after the fact, and it will benefit from doing it in a multidisciplinary context. So this is I think this is what we're facing, the key problem when we're talking about this world of ethics, of law and society. So values, norms, laws, ideals, ethics, and principles that have a particular direction of fit. The world should obey these things here, right? And these are just examples. So how many values are there? 155, 73? Well, certainly not two, not 30. But so you have an example. These things should be designed in compliance or to express and implement these things here. And once we have sunk 300, 500 million or billions into it, we should be able to justify an audit that we have done a really good job from that point of view. We have to realize that values are built into information systems, I'm preaching to the converted here, at every level of an information system. So at interfaces, the ontologies, the algorithms, the code, everywhere, right? That is a mechanism design that is implemented into systems. Values are built into it, hundreds of tiny little decisions that all add up to form the system that will then have a real effect, as Paul pointed out. It will shape our life. These things that are designed will do that. And if we don't do it, or you don't do it systematically, continually, and consciously for moral reasons, others will do it for self-interested reasons, and we know, among others, who these people will be. So if we approach the ethical issues of a digital society along these lines, then we will demonstrate that we are effectively trying to take our moral responsibility. We will thereby increase legitimacy, trust, transparency, and accountability. And we will do two other things, which I will talk about in the second part, the 5 minutes that are left. Address a problem of what we call moral overload, and they relate to the examples I gave of the Dutch Fairphone. And we will help ourselves to get an empirical cycle in ethics of technology going. So this is the tragic condition that we're in, and it's called value pluralism. It's tragic, it's good at the same time. There are a number of values, and we cannot shop selectively. We cannot say, oh, let's forget about dignity today, let's focus on sustainability. You cannot do that. You have to do all of these things at the same time. That's the condition that we're in. But we're bound to run into conflicts and dilemmas. Now, is this a real problem? No, not necessarily. It could also be a challenge, and it could be a trigger for innovation and creativity. But only if we don't make it easy on ourselves and just skip a couple of those, right? then we're cheating, because we cannot do that. We have to do a good job from all of these points of view. Now, this is what we call the problem of moral overload. We have to do prosperity and sustainability, security and privacy. Carl, you also had the different conflicts between accountability and privacy. Efficiency, safety, accountability, and confidentiality. Now, this is a case where it went wrong. This is a very sustainable but unsafe bus. It blew up in the Netherlands, optimized on sustainability, very light material, liquid gas, bang, forgotten about the safety. That's not what we need to do. We need to have both. We have to have a sustainable and a safe bus, right? These problems you see everywhere. Nationwide electronic patient record system. This is, according to a university study, 300 million wasted innovation because the privacy, this is a couple of years ago, you will remember this case, it came to the upper house and they rejected 5 years of work and in the infrastructure. It would have been from the patient safety, from the limiting the cost in healthcare, would be a great idea. Oh, sorry, forgotten about the privacy. Not taken seriously enough at the very early stages of the design of these systems. Same thing in smart grids, right? Discussion in the upper house, smart meter from a CO2 reduction and meeting our targets in Europe, a great idea, but forgotten about the privacy. Engineers claimed that this was a smart meter. It wasn't that smart because they forgot to incorporate the privacy. They could have done a much better job. So, what's the structure of the problem? We want our sustainability, we want our privacy. Think about the camera system, the eternal debates about privacy and security in the street. So this is this tension, privacy versus security. The moral overload problem is the following. You want your privacy above a certain threshold level, you want your security above a certain threshold level. But you're stuck with a first generation 1.0 camera system, a fairly stupid camera system that gives you neither privacy nor security. You hang it everywhere and gives you razor sharp images of the innocent citizens and blurred images of the crooks. So that's not very helpful. Or you have a move to a second generation camera system, much better. You hang it everywhere, you have a lot of security but no privacy. Or you decide not to hang it everywhere, you have a lot of privacy but no security. You feel you have to move into this area where you satisfy both of your values above a certain threshold level. People thinking function should forget about this. It is about these points where you want to be. So you want to move in this direction. Innovation, we found, is often the move to an area where you satisfy more of your moral values than you could before you started to change and add your new functionality to the world. And this is miraculously a little bit of philosophy. If there is an obligation to do both A and B, right, you have a second order obligation to see to it that you can do both A and B. And that's exactly what innovation is doing. So it's taking serious all of those values like privacy, sustainability, and safety, and security, and accountability. We all need to do these things. And we do not, let's say, surrender in the face of this multiplicity of ethical demands, but we try to change the world, to design the world in such a way that we can do that, right? So the axiom of responsible innovation is, if you can change the world by innovation today, so that you can satisfy more of your obligations tomorrow, you have a moral obligation to innovate today. This follows from what we said before. So can all problems be solved in this way? No. But some important questions can. And we have, if the stakes are high enough, we have at least the obligation to try and see whether we can reach those solutions in the right-hand upper square. So people are working is, it also brings you business, right? After Snowden, the rest of the world comes and shops in Europe. because we do some privacy respecting technologies. At least we have been forced, we have forced ourselves to work on these things. So designing for X, where X ranges over a number of values. We've done a book, it's 500 pages, so we have a lot of the methodology and the cases there. Designing for X, and X ranges over whatever value you have, but you have to take on board that you cannot shop selectively. You can work on some things first, but you have to also think about the other things. So we're looking at a picture where we functionally we look at these moral requirements as supra-functional requirements, and we have to decompose them until they map upon features of the system. Right. So think about democracy. Well, there's a number of theories of democracy, and if you're interested in deliberative, you're probably interested in some diversity, and then probably you have to make sure that diversity is there. If you have a kind of a contestatory idea of democracy, you have to make sure that there's information that is reliable, etc. If you have direct, you have to make sure that the people are exhibit some level of independence, etc. So, same kind of triangle. You start with your abstract values, you have to decompose them, and then you have to kind of further specify them into design requirements that engineers can work with. This kind of is the image that would bring the engineers and the moral philosophers together, because the moral philosophers are here, they have to descend in this area where they can speak in a meaningful way to the engineers. So think of these as high-level supra-functional requirements that need to be decomposed in this way. We do this kind of stuff, and this is a platform in which we can work with our engineer colleagues from engineering schools. We can do these kind of things. And the second point, and I will conclude on that, is in this way we do something revolutionary in ethics. We help ourselves to data points. Quine, the logician and philosopher of science, said, you know, this ethics is an infirm discipline. There are no data points. What are your data points? Now, in this way, what you can do is you start with very high in the triangle, a certain notion, your conception of what equality is, then you decompose it and specify it, and then you say, well, okay, but then we have to do deliberation. Okay, but then you say, what would deliberation online look like? Then you have some empirical findings in whether, you know, people are really doing what you want them to do in that context, and then you feed that back into this, right? And then you go through circles. In this way, you can really, in an agile way almost, kind of speed up the development of your ethical ideas. You get some traction and some empirical findings. It used to be the case that we wrote a constitution and had to wait 200 years for a revolution to occur to redraft the constitution. Now we can work with a certain ethical idea, we can do mechanism design, we can design systems, we can have experiences with them, and we can feed that back into our initial ethical ideas. That's what I want to share with you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.